I can't believe it. I'm actually looking in the very mirror that Jimi Hendrix would have looked in when he lived here. You know, Dan, they say when you stare in this mirror too long, you actually see a ghost.
Everyone, and welcome to GI Weekly, live from Jimi Hendrix's bedroom.
Yes.
Somewhere near Bond Street.
Yeah, we're at 23/25, depending on whether you're in Handel's flat or Hendrix's flat. I think we're 23 right here for the Handel and Hendrix Museum. And yeah, we are actually in Jimmy's bedroom, which is quite a privilege. We've got our guitars here.
It's all about Jimmy today.
Absolutely, yeah. So you probably can see there's a little bit of a Hendrix theme we got going on here with the Stratocasters. We got the Marshall type.
Cornford,
and
we've got a new vibe here, which is a rework of the Univibe. We've got some wah pedals. I can smell the love making. I can smell the weed in the walls. It's yeah. And thanks very much to the kind people at Handel and Hendrix for having us here, because this is just amazing, you know.
Well, we've got some great stuff coming up, because not only are we going to do some playing here in this incredible space, this flat, but also we're going to take you around the museum, show you a little bit of it, so you can come and visit yourself and see what's in store. And we've also got a very special surprise. Do you want to tell them?
A 1951 Epiphone.
Absolutely.
Played by Jimi Hendrix himself whilst he was in this flat.
He used to live in here. Hendrix lived here for the three years that he was in London. This was his only registered address.
So that would have been the first album.
All the way through the first album, all the way right through. So you're talking 67. I mean, he arrived here 66, so we're 50 years from when he actually arrived. But from like 67 right up till 70.
That would be the main part of all you experienced as well. Would have been like,
absolutely.
Could have been written in this room.
It could have been. It was his only registered address. I know he spent a lot of time in hotels, etc. But this space right here, this incredible space, and the fantastic people at Handel and Hendrix have decided to honour it, because for such a long time, it was just it was kind of forgotten. Really, it was.
Yeah, the Beatles have got theirs up in Liverpool. Mm. You know, there's Graceland in the States. Mm-hmm. You know, this is Jimmy's humble abode.
Yeah,
it's not Graceland, but it's pretty amazing how they've recreated it using photos and using all the information, from people at the time, and it's pretty damn realistic.
Yeah,
guys,
you're really gonna have to come and check it out. Yeah. It's incredible. So should we do a little bit of playing?
Yeah. All right. That ended abruptly. No, well, I was still going for the, you know, the...
some plastic.
Well, you know, we have to get through the show because we're under a real time restriction today. True. Hence why why I'm sweating a bit, because we've got, how long have we got? We've got about 45 minutes till they're going to kick us out. So we've got to crack on with
this. They don't even know we're here.
No, we're just stuck in. So talking about, we've just had a play, so let's have a look at some of the stuff we've got with us in a bit more detail. I think a lot of it's on the floor, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
I don't know if you can get some of that, James. Do you want to go through what you've got there?
Yeah, so I got the Jimmy's calling in the background, by the way. I don't know, there's a lot of cool noises happening in the background. We've got the Octafuzz here, which is based on the Roger Mayer Octavia, but also you've got the fuzz pedal built into this there, so you can, you know, if you just want some fuzz action. Might help to switch on.
Yeah, it was good.
And then when
that's
you
a cool sound effect.
Yeah, and then when you whack on that octave effect there, you know, you get the...
Oh, yeah.
You know what you hear in...
That's very Jimmy.
You got to really be kind of almost a little bit subtle with it, because if you go light... You can just hear the octave. You go too hard with it, it gets a bit out of control, but...
But you can imagine that through his, because he used to play his Marshall amps cranked to the absolute maximum.
Absolutely.
And they'd do all of his control with the tone knob of his, with the volume knob of his guitar.
That's it.
And I'm reading up on it, I mean, I don't know about you, I've been spending the last sort of week sort of getting my head into grips of real, the technicalities of how he created his sound. And he was very much, I mean, you know from his playing, but it was, you know, it's how he used the guitar.
Of course.
As much as he was a pioneer of effects. Unless you've got that touch and that control over the instrument, I think you can't do anything.
Well, that's why I don't think there's really anyone who's really replicated them. I mean, there's such a huge influence. I mean, I would say for me, he's my favourite guitar player of all time, really. I think I probably went through a little bit of a period in my teenage years, you know, maybe like 3 or 4 years into playing guitar, where I kind of went off it a little bit. It was like the first big guitar player I got into. Then when I started getting into more of the shredder type guys, I kind of forgot about him for a bit. Not forget, but...
Yeah, you move on to other things, right?
Yeah, you know, but I always keep coming back to him, and there's always new stuff to discover. And if you're one of these guys that sort of thinks, oh, Hendrix, better guys come along, you've really not listened to enough.
I think it's the mixture of technicalities in his playing.
Yeah.
Because you can feel like the R&B influence from when he was playing with like Little Richard and people like that back in the day.
Definitely.
You know, and then you can feel the real heavy blues influence, the Howlin' Wolf and people like that. And then this pioneer spirit of trying to do something completely different.
Definitely.
You know, and no one's really made the kind of impact, you know, that he made in 66 or 67 when he came to London.
Definitely.
You know, and he scared the bejesus out of Eric Clapton, you know, when he turned up at, you know, I think it was the Astoria down the road.
Everybody that played for him. I mean, the thing about it is that he spent quite a lot of time in the sort of mid-60s, even some of the early 60s, you know, backing other artists.
Yeah.
But then he seemed to just explode onto the scene when he came to the UK. You know, 66 he arrived here. Late 66, and then by early 67 he had a hit record with Hey Joe. So to a lot of people here, it just seemed like he just exploded on the scene. He had been working quite a bit.
That's always the way.
Yeah.
It's the overnight success that took 20 years to...
Of course, but in terms of, you know, in this country, it was just a, you know, right guy, right place, right time.
Great band.
Great band as well, absolutely. That goes without saying. And but let's go back to the pedals a little bit here. We've both got wahs.
Of course we have, because this is Jimi Hendrix.
Absolutely, so you're going to need some wah. There's some great wah action. But you look like you've got some other wah there. What's the deal with that thing?
I've got an expression pedal for the new vibe, which would have been the Univibe back in the day.
Right.
But Jimmy played it with an expression pedal, according to my research. Mm. People may question that. But that essentially controls the speed. So if you listen, I can turn that. If I turn the intensity up, you'll get more of a feel for it. Mm. But you'll get that. So it's like a chorus or a vibrato.
Yeah.
I mean, it's got an option for both there, but it sounds like a bit of a mix between the two.
I'm pretty sure Machine Gun's got that sound, hasn't
exactly
it?
Exactly that sound. Mm. And also the beginning of Little Wing. He uses it very lightly on the top of that.
Makes a lot of sense.
You can hear it in that, because that clean sound is so beautiful, but there is a little shimmer to it, which I think comes from this.
Definitely.
But he used it quite a lot. Mm. He used it a lot with overdrives as well, because you end up with that, you know, if you were that Octafuzz with that, and you end up saying, crazy, man. Yeah, crazy. Yeah. But you can hear that.
Really nice. Yeah, yeah. What's the deal with that like Strat then?
This one? Mm. I'd like to say it was a pre-CBS, you know, 63 like
not?
He was playing.
Yeah, yeah.
No, no. Mm. This is a Mexican Strat.
Right.
But it's been wrecked by someone. But I've got to thank Luke Haling for lending me this guitar. Mm. But yeah, I was looking into Strats a bit, and you know, they were talking about how he you know, the reverse of the guitar and what kind of effect that happened. Mm. And there's loads of stuff people talking about the pickups being the thing. Actually, I was reading a thing from Roger Mayer himself, who's guitar tech, who said actually it had very little to do with the strings,
right?
With the pickups, sorry,
okay.
And was more to do with the scale length, because if you're reversing the strings up, then you've got a longer scale length for your low E and a higher one, so you end up. That's why you tune down to an E flat, because it was easier to bend the string.
Mm.
So some interesting. Also, some of the cavities, because the cavities were in different positions.
I see.
And also, he played with some very strange, like bespoke strings. So we had a lower gauge G string, which is down to a 13.
Right.
So we didn't get that G heavy kind of thing. So they're really balanced. So a lot of the time, you know, it's about how he had the guitar set up as well. You know.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think that's all those little tiny points really that make up the Jimi Hendrix sound. I think probably the pickups being round the other way as well. You would imagine that probably would make some sort of difference to the tones.
Must have a little bit of difference, but it was only because that Mayer was saying that he didn't think it had a huge amount of impact.
Well, he is the expert,
exactly.
So you know, I'm not going to argue with that.
But yeah, for this pedal, you know, you can get those kind of. It's a great sounding pedal,
absolutely.
Isn't it?
Really, incredible.
So thank you to Korg for that one. I don't know if you could use that on a pedal board. It's huge.
It's as big as a pedal board, really, isn't it?
I mean, it is as big. Mm. Some people have smaller pedal boards. Mm. It's a great one for the studio.
Yeah.
You know, that's the type of thing you want lying around. Mm. And, you know, if you were in a Jimmy's covers band, it'd probably be a good one to have.
I mean, I think the thing is as well, this is like the high-end one, you know, so if you really, it's maybe not your entry-level to this effect. There are smaller versions,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah, the TC Electronics do one. There's a few different makers that do, Fullerton do a version, and they're all, that's about 350 quid, So yeah, maybe a little bit out of this price range.
But that's really about it for you know, Hendrix pedals, because
what have you got in your guitar? What have you got? This is your one, isn't it?
This is my guitar. Yeah, this is my. We will go into this in a little bit more detail in another episode, because there's quite a lot to talk about with this. This is my kind of Frankenstein, really, of a 63 and 64 head and body, neck and body, I should say, put together. I won't tell you what I paid for it, but you know, it's a lovely sounding guitar. But the thing about it is that, you know, it does have, because it's so old, it's got little creaks and cracks, and the string kind of hangs off a little bit there.
Yeah.
But
limitations can be good, man.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
It's you know, it's cool.
It's a nice sounding rig you've got.
It's a cool little guitar, and the old Cornford there, the Cornford 6-watt Harlequin, which if you can pick one of those up, but they don't make them anymore. But they are real nice amps.
So what are we saying now? You know. I've been listening to Hendrix non-stop for the last week.
Yep.
I've been researching him. I feel like I've lived a little bit, and now I'm in his room.
Yep.
What would you say is the sort of key thing for, you know, creating that sound, technique-wise?
Technique-wise, you need this chord.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That's the one, isn't it?
You know, a lot of pentatonics with... You know, kind of unusual bit.
Yeah. So what are you doing there again?
So I'm kind of taking it up this top part of the pentatonic scale, but you know, when you want to do the bend on, say, 15 on the B, and then you want to just catch the G string. So you're kind of getting that flat fiving.
That's
and quite a lot of the time as well with Hendrix, rather than going... Which, I mean, again, that does have that Hendrix sound. He will go, you know, get these strong bends and stuff, but quite a lot of the time there's little subtleties, like the... Just get into there.
But he uses a lot of pentatonics.
He does use a lot
of... For the people out there who maybe are a bit like, oh, pentatonics, he uses them really creatively, and he uses a lot of like chromatics and stuff as well, you know. Because I don't get the feeling, I mean, I might be right, I don't get the feeling he was... He wasn't like, he probably didn't study in that sense. He used his ears.
Well,
so I imagine a lot of, because you, like, for example, Little Wing, we were just talking about that before we started playing. I don't think you write something like that.
Yeah.
I don't think he sat there in the same sense that you'd write it. I think as a jam. He sat there and he had some chord sequence and he just went in there and he was playing, and that's, do you know what I mean? It was more of a natural kind of
thing. I think he had a kind of, you know, you see quite a lot when he'd be playing, rather than doing a jam like that, you know, he kind of would go for more of this, thumb over the neck type thing. And I think that's the thing, like, you know, he liked to have, he had, I think, certain little patterns for, you know, your root on E, your root on A's. And he would kind of really stick around that. But yeah, you're right. I mean, there's a lot of chromatics. It sounds like chromatics anyway.
It's flat fives and,
you know. Yeah, so, I mean, if he was going to go down, like, say he was going to do, you know, one of these type of phrases.
You know, he's using the blues scale, isn't he?
Well, there you go. I'm using the blues. And then I'm going to the major thirds. You know, and especially with bends, you know.
King of the riff.
Well, you know, there that's kind of unusual because I'm using minor pentatonic. I'm going to the major thirds, but it's like no one went to do something like that.
Yeah, but that's ears, isn't it? You know, I think he probably had, you know, just great ears for, you know, and going with his guts and had the technique to be able to just do that. You know what I mean? He was, you know, one of a kind. You know? Don't try and recreate him.
No.
Just take some good stuff from him. You know?
Absolutely, absolutely.
But great songwriter as well, and I think underrated, especially for the first album, Are You Experienced. Some great songs on there. Really great, great songwriting. With, you know, and he wasn't a great vocalist, but he wrote some killer hooks, you know.
Yeah, I mean, I think, I would say he was a great vocalist, in my opinion, because he really said everything he needed to say from his voice. And the best example, I think, of that is Little Wing, because there's so many covers out there of people doing Little Wing. I've even tried to do it myself, you know. But, you know, even the best
coming
of them,
in the next episode, guys.
You know, but even in the best singers, you know, Paul Rodgers or whatever, I never think anyone does it as well as Jimmy.
Because I suppose there's an understatedness, because he wasn't a natural singer, there's an understatedness. And also, you know, it's an iconic voice. Start with Dylan. I mean, Dylan's a great songwriter, but not a virtuoso singer. Yeah. But you know it's Dylan straight away. Yeah. Same with, you know, Jimmy. You know it's him as soon as he starts singing.
Absolutely, yeah, definitely.
So yeah, I think, you know, go out and buy yourself some pedals to sound like Jimi Hendrix. I mean, that's pretty much it, because it's a great week.
Get a Strat,
Pedals. Get some pedals.
Get a Marshall or a Fender amp and crank it.
Next time, if you're going to bring a Princeton like I did, bring some kind of pedal, because I sound a bit lightweight.
I brought the Princeton. Okay, so we've got something really extra special.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, this is like once in a lifetime type stuff right here. So we have Jimi Hendrix owned acoustic guitar, Epiphone, 1951. In fact, something that's kind of important about this guitar, well, we'll open that up first, eh, and then we'll talk about what's important.
Cool.
So,
this has been kindly lent to us by a benefactor.
Yep.
And it has Simone in the corner, who's wearing white gloves.
Lovely Simone.
Because we're not actually allowed to pick this up because it's worth more than my house.
Yeah, it is.
And there she is in all her glory. Go on, then give us some more details.
Well, something that's quite, you know, very unique about this particular instrument is that Jimmy had, you know, a lot of guitars over his short life, but quite a lot of them came and went. With this one, this was the, you know, the one that he had for the longest period of time. He had this for over three years.
Wow.
And like all along the Watchtower. he put together, like he would sit and he would play like the Bob Dylan version. He reworked that using this guitar.
Wow, man.
Obviously, it's not like whether it was recorded using that guitar, I'm not sure.
But he was songwriting.
There's about 14 guitars on that, so you may have actually.
This
find
may be one of them. Yeah, you
maybe
never
one
know.
Of them. But this was apparently what he would use in this room as well, and so it's incredible.
And it looks like it's got the original string still on it.
Yep. Yeah, it's just so incredible, even just to be close to it.
Is this? Yeah, yeah. It's a lefty, which is good because it means we can't play it, otherwise we get ourselves in trouble. What we do have to say is because it's been kindly loaned to us, it's actually up for auction.
It is,
isn't
yes.
it?
Yeah, it's going to be at Bonhams at the 15th of December. So if you've got about £500,000 to spare.
Yeah,
well,
I think
like
starting
that.
Price is 150.
150,000, right?
Just starting price. Mm. So, so we'll see. It'd be interesting to see how much it goes for because if I was a multi-gazillionaire, I'd probably spend £500,000
Absolutely.
On it.
Absolutely. So check out Bonham's Auction House, 15th of December, for your chance to get this once in a lifetime instrument.
It's a shame we can't give it away as a prize, but we're not bankrupt like that.
No, not quite. Okay, we're here with Sean from Handel and Hendrix, and he's going to give us a little look at the highlights of what you're going to see when you visit Handel and Hendrix yourself. So, why don't you tell us a little bit about this room that we're in right now?
Yeah, of course. So, you've seen Hendrix's bedroom. This would have been his kind of spare room, so where he kept his gear, amps, like leftover stuff, like his electric guitars. You've obviously seen the Epiphone acoustic, which he wrote his songs on. This is where he kept all his electric guitars. We can get him up when he needed them.
All right.
And also, I don't know if you can see out there, there's a little balcony they used to go out and drink and just sit out there and have parties basically and smoke and all the rest of it. So, pretty good view over Mayfair there.
Absolutely. So, you've got to set up as like a record.
So, we've kind of used this room as an exhibition on Hendrix's record collection, which we've got a list of all the records he had when he was living here at Mayfair. You can see from the wall here some of the kind of highlights. There's some things that you'd obviously expect. A lot of blues, Howlin' Wolf, Muddy Waters, some Dylan, unusual 60s stuff, some like John Mayall.
That's a good collection.
Johnson, but there's some kind of stranger things in there. You've got Ravi Shankar, Django Reinhardt, and interestingly, you've got Handel and Hendrix. When he moved in, there was already the blue plaque that said Handel lived here, and Hendrix got the idea that he was actually living in the same house as Handel.
Oh.
Handel lived next door, but Jimmy thought he could kind of feel Handel's aura and all the rest of it. So he, as soon as he knew, he went out to, I think he, like, there's a HMV on Oxford Street that's been there since the 60s, and there was a record store called One Stop Records. And he went out and bought some Handel, and we can tell by the actual record, by like how worn it is,
that really?
He listened to it quite a lot. We've had people come and kind of say, oh, maybe there's connections.
Maybe.
I'm not sure about that.
It's too many talented people anyway, you know.
And yeah, there's some interesting stories, like apparently he saw Handel's ghost.
Well, we were trying to see it in the mirror. Yeah, is that right? We were looking to see whether we could spot it, but maybe James caught it on camera. You know, we'll test the footage, you know. So what have we got in here then, Sean?
So this room we've just turned into a whole exhibition space about Hendrix's life here in London. We've got, you know, how he found the flat, what he was doing when he was living here, a bit about the gigs and the jams and all that kind of stuff.
So this covers his time in London then. So how long was he actually in the flat for?
So we moved in July 1968, mm-hmm. and then went straight off on tour, and then came back in the winter of 1969. So it's not really known how long he spent here, but it would, you know, did loads of jams and like interviews and stuff here.
So this is quite a collage here of events. So yes, it's just and quite a lot of the stuff as well. It shows you Jimmy actually in the flat as well.
Yeah, totally.
Oh, fantastic.
I mean, one of the cool things is George Harrison used to use this place as a bit of a ghetto. I think it was when there was a bit of kind of issues with the Beatles and the recordings weren't going so well. So he used to come here because he was good friends with Jimmy.
Yeah.
And we know that he stayed upstairs in the spare bedroom.
Right. Okay.
So yeah.
So what's, have you seen there, up there, the spare bedroom? What's
that's actually our office now.
Oh, so I see, right, okay, I see, so.
One day we'll turn it into.
You turn that part into as well, probably. Yeah. So we've got the replica over there of the guitar that we checked out before. It's very kind of you to let us try it out, but it's a pretty nice replica as well.
Yeah, we've got a bit about, like two of the most famous gigs he did in London, in the Royal Albert Hall. Which is while he was living in the flat. Apparently the first night didn't go so well, some technical difficulties, but he pulled out all the stops on the second night.
Right.
One of the most famous Hendrix gigs in London. So we don't usually use these stairs because they're so rickety and old and creaky that we can't take too many people on them.
Right.
But we can go down there. And these are the stairs that people would have had to have gone up to get to Jimmy's flat. So. Yeah, there's some accounts of people coming up here and having to go, you know, through the dark stairs up all the way up to the third floor and, you know, like knock on some strange door and Jimi Hendrix would be there. It's kind of quite odd.
All right, Sean, thanks so much for taking the time to show us around.
Thanks for coming.
And come and visit Handel and Hendrix.
Yeah, please do.